Good morning, friends. You know it's going to be a great day when there is an announcement that I cannot miss, and it's really the only one left for me, that says, Larry, your carrot cake is in the fridge. It's a great day already. Welcome to a very special church family. On a very special day, we want to thank members of our chancel choir and our bell choir for sharing and preparing a very special musical offering for us all, not only to enjoy, but to be the catalyst for our praise of our loving Lord this day. You're among friends, and may God's Spirit moving in our midst touch you and bless you. We encourage you kindly, try to use the friendship pads. That helps us be more aware of all of the many special persons who are with us on a given morning. It really helps, and we also want to greet the many who have joined us online, who are a part of our streaming ministry. You know, if you don't know already, you can go back and you can watch any of our preceding worship services. And that's a special ministry to offer. We want to remind you, particularly parents, of the mission trip meeting that Drew Hood has called for right after this service in the Media Center. Get it right. Thank you. A couple of other announcements to put before you this morning. Included in that is a special family ministry offering, the blessing of the bikes today. Begin by gathering in Fellowship Hall. Grateful for all of the joy that is shared in those kinds of experiences. Remembering summer education for all ages begins on the 3rd, not that far off. No classes next Sunday. And a reminder, as well as signups for the upcoming spring sale, which are a special part of Lawn Fete, are taking place today in the cafe area. This is also Pentecost Sunday, where we celebrate the gift of God's Spirit, calling the church into being. And there is, as a part of our denominational offerings, a special Pentecost offering. And that envelope should be somewhere in the seat or pew before you, particularly targeted to children at risk, youth, and young adults, as our denomination tries to be responsive and engaging. As the Church of Christ, we are grateful for those who provide leadership in our midst, our elected officers, and particularly this morning, the session has asked to share a word with this congregation. Speaking on their behalf is Elder Sandy Caney, but I invite all elders at this time who are able to come forward, please.
Good morning. I'm Sandy Caney. Here's the rest. And I have the privilege to speak to you as a member of your session. For the past 2 months, session has focused on the fall schedule for Sycamore Presbyterian Church. We listened to members of our committees. We had five listening sessions for members of the congregation. We listened to individual members and read your emails. And most of all, we prayed a lot. We had a special meeting in which we discussed all that we had heard and the pros and the cons of the many options. At our regularly scheduled meeting, our only business was to come up with the best schedule to glorify God and to fulfill the needs of the most people possible. This is our decision. There will be two services in the fall, 8:45 and 10:45. Both services will be traditional in style and format. The chancel choir will be leading worship at both services. During the 10:45 service, there will be concurrent Sunday school. At 9:45, there will be expanded opportunities for fellowship, adult education, student, and children's ministries. Session will host a congregational discussion on Sunday, June 17th, after the worship service in the chapel to cover more details. I wish there was an option that would make everyone happy. Not all of us agreed on everything in the final solution, but we have prayed. This is God's church, and we believe that this is where He has led us. Thank you.
We thank Sandy and your elders for standing forward in leadership. And for those of you who have not taken advantage of the opportunity to read some of your email communications, there is a hard copy of the congregational email that was sent on Tuesday out on the counter in the cafe. And now may we prepare our hearts to worship God.
It is always a blessing when we can gather as God's people for worship. Will you join me in this morning's call to worship printed in your bulletin? God has given us breath to live and spirit to sing. God has gathered us into a community of care and worship. The Holy One says, "To whom will you compare me? Who is my equal?"
Oh,
join me in this morning's prayer of confession? Eternal God, our judge and redeemer, we confess that we have tried to hide areas of our lives from you, for we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have lived for ourselves, and apart from you, we have turned from our neighbors and refused to bear the burdens of others. We have ignored the pain of the world and passed by the hungry, the poor, and the oppressed. In your great mercy, forgive our sins and free us from selfishness, that we may choose your will and obey your commandments. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Let's take a few moments this morning for silent prayer and confession. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in loving kindness. He has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is God's loving kindness towards those who fear him. Hear and believe the good news. Seated.
Thank you.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 4, verses 16 through 30. He went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Then he rolled up the scroll and gave it back to the attendant and sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. He began by saying to them, "Today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. "Isn't this Joseph's son?" they asked. Jesus said to them, "Surely you will quote this proverb to me, 'Physician, heal thyself,' and you will tell me, 'Do here in your hometown what we have heard that you did in Capernaum.' Truly I tell you," he continued, "no prophet is accepted in his hometown. I assure you that there were many widows in Israel in Elijah's time, when the sky was shut for 3.5 years and there was a severe famine throughout the land. Yet Elijah was not sent to any of them, but to a widow in Zarephath in the region of Sidon. And there were many in Israel with leprosy in the time of Elisha the prophet, yet not one of them was cleansed, only Naaman the Syrian." All of the people in the synagogue were furious when they heard this. They got up and drove him out of the town and took to him to the brow of the hill on which the town was built, in order to throw him off the cliff. But he walked right through the crowd and went on his way. This is the word of the Lord.
It is time for the children's message, so come on down. A few more. So, buenos dias, guten tag, bonjour, mahalo, shalom, good morning. So, all those other ways of me saying good morning are different languages: German, Hawaiian, Hebrew is shalom. If I say something to you in a different language and you don't know that language, it doesn't mean anything. Just like this morning, if we had somebody here from Paris, France, and they never learned English, and I said good morning, they wouldn't know I was saying good morning. I'd have to say bonjour. Well, today is Pentecost, and I love that the church, it's part of the church's calendar, and it's one of my favorite remembrances and something I hold dear to my heart for Pentecost, and I'm going to talk about that today. You see, after Jesus died and was resurrected, while he was here on earth, he kept promising his disciples that he would always be with them and that he would give them the power to go out and do their own thing and to tell everybody about him. But it's pretty hard when you can't see somebody or touch them to believe in that. Well, there was a Jewish holiday, and I'm going to see if I can say it, Shavuot, which was the celebration of the Jews going to Jerusalem, because that was the remembrance for them of when Moses got the Ten Commandments. So there were all these people in Jerusalem, and while they were there and the disciples were there, all of a sudden this loud wind kicked up. It wasn't blowing trees over or knocking huts over, but they could just hear this and it was so loud. And then all of a sudden, the Bible tells us that there were like tongues of fire that were on top of the disciples' head, but it wasn't burning them, it was just there. And people that were in their houses heard this and they came out like, "What is going on here?" It was Jesus' promise, and we call that the Holy Spirit. And that's what we celebrate with Pentecost. It's the day that Jesus gave us the power, or the Holy Spirit, to do his work. Now, how do you know if you have the Holy Spirit? I can only tell you what it means to me. So for me, when I pray, sometimes I get teary-eyed because in my heart, there are words that I cannot say, but I know God knows that they're there. And that's what happened on Pentecost. The disciples were talking in languages that they had never even learned in school. They were talking German, and they're like, well, wait, what's up with this? I never learned German. That's how I feel sometimes when I pray. Well, today is Music Sunday. Another way for me to feel the Holy Spirit is when I hear this music, because it wells something up in my heart that I can't put words to. And so I know that God is giving me that power to go out all week and be the Christian that he wants me to be. That's what the Holy Spirit is. Some of you are really into nature. If you've seen the Grand Canyon, or you see a deer walking through the woods, or I look out over the ocean, and I look and I'm like, oh my gosh, this is so big. God is so much bigger than I am that I don't have to worry about the little stuff. That's what Pentecost is about. God has given us the Holy Spirit to go out here all week and have the power to do his work. Whether we do that by telling other people or inviting friends to church, or whether we just show people through our actions that we're Christ followers, which means we're Christians. So let's pray for a little bit of strength to do that. Dear God, thank you for sending your Holy Spirit to be our teacher and guide. Help us to use the power of the Holy Spirit to teach others about your Son, Jesus, not only with our words, but with our actions. Amen. All right, so if you are not in preschool K, PK, you get to stay and listen to the awesome music. The rest of you, we're going to go out with Miss Susan. Parents, just know at this time, June 3rd, you will take your children directly to class instead of them coming here first. If you have any questions, let me know.
Thank you.
Friends, will you please pray with me? As only you can, O Lord, put the loving fire of your Spirit deep within us, that we might give you glory through Christ our loving Lord. Amen. I didn't see it coming. It was Mother's Day afternoon, and I was taking our grandson back home. He'd been over for a visit to see Grandma. And as I put him in his car seat, I said, Kai, I'm going to let you hear a little bit of Grandpa music, something that I used to listen to when I was a boy, and I still listen to. It's a group called The Beatles. And he said, The Beatles? Now remember, he's still in his threes. What he said to me next was, is it rock and roll? I said, yes. Yes, it is. It'll sound a little different, but I think you'll like it. Now, imagine, what might be the first Beatles song I would introduce him to? Got a guess? He sensed the joy. He could hear the music. He liked it. The energy, the sense of hopefulness. Part of our great challenge in life is to try to hear the music. That's what we're going to talk about. I shared a common love of music with a late colleague, Reverend Shirley Hutchins. I've been thinking about Shirley all week because it was in this window of time where she was to have returned to work 4 years ago. Sadly, that never happened. I can still see Shirley, and for those of you who didn't know Shirley, that's a great picture of her. I can still see Shirley in that lime green pantsuit that she loved to wear the first time I interviewed her, and we discovered that we graduated the same year from high school, which meant we grew up listening to the same music, and she loved some of rock and folk and bluegrass and country and gospel and classical. Shirley was thoroughly Southern. She baked in a way that would bring you to your knees. What an alive and beautiful spirit. She was unfailingly polite. She would sometimes call me, sir. I said, you don't have to call me sir. Later on, she'd call me bud. I loved that. Shirley would speak of this congregation as being the kind of congregation she read about in seminary, never believing she'd have an opportunity to serve here. She also had this depth of spirit that recognized she believed that she had been led to Sycamore because the good people of this church would take care of her. And that will forever be part of the Sycamore legacy, that legacy of love. Shirley had been here about 2.5 years, and she received a cancer diagnosis. She went through surgery and the follow-up treatments. She returned to work, and we were so hopeful about her moving forward. About 1.5 years later, I can still see her leaning on the counter in the main office, talking about a pain that was growing that caused her great discomfort and worry, and a number of us encouraged her to return to see her surgeon, and in fact, there was a cancer reoccurrence. And she would go through surgery again, and then the struggle of going through the following treatments, how we prayed that she would return to work. Shirley shared with me at one point in the middle of all that, that there was a time when she couldn't hear the music any longer. It was as if darkness had invaded her world. The melodies of hope were gone. The songs of encouragement had vanished. The sense of being lifted up was nowhere to be found. She yearned to hear the music again. And she did. And she would. We actually recast her job description, anticipating her return with her blessing to take advantage of some of the new experiences in her life and world. And then 2 weeks before she was going to return, she called me, and I will never forget her first three words. She said, "I'm gonna die." We didn't want that to happen. We also didn't want her to suffer. And yet there was music alive in her spirit as she would talk very openly about a God that she knew loved her, about an end of pain that would be coming, about an eternal belonging that death could not separate us from. She began to hear brave music. Music that would stir her heart and helped her know that she was in God's grip and that Christ had a claim on her life. And when she died 5 weeks later, we knew that she died secure in the arms of her Lord. I wanted a memento, a remembrance of Shirley. There were many things in her office. There were many, many things in her office. Did you know there were many things in Shirley's office? God love her. And the one piece I took was her CD set of the Messiah. Words which sang to her spirit about Christ's triumphant love made real in his resurrection, which could defeat anything death and darkness could throw our way. And she believed in that. And you know, she had taught a class on that. Some of you here may have been a part of that study group on the Messiah. A friend had been through that class and was deeply grieving. And I did something Shirley would have done. I gave him her CD set, knowing that Shirley believed that the life-giving musical sounds of our Lord's care are meant to be passed on, but you'd better be singing them out as well. Like all of you, there are times when I struggle to hear the music. Maybe sometimes it's just the scope of responsibility, or you get tired, or it may feel like you've got 1,100 bosses. Sometimes the depth of pastoral care need just gets hard, and you lean deeply, as Shirley would say, into Christ's strength and care. And so for me, to hear the music, sometimes I got to go away. And I did that about 2 weeks ago. Went for 4 nights. And for those who would just think I go to camp to drink beer and sleep a lot, I want you to know that I read three books during that time. One with an influence for a summer series, one for the fall, and one for the Advent season. But I had a new companion with me this time. Some of you know we have a rescue from Hurricane Harvey whose name is Vinny. Well, he was my camping companion. And it got cold one night, and I took this picture of Vinny under underneath the covers. He didn't want to get out. And then one night, it stormed, it lightened, it thundered, it rained. In fact, it flooded part of our tent. And I think he thought he was back in Hurricane Harvey because suddenly he's on my cot looking down at me like, what is this? But then things got calmer. And here's Vinny on my cot. He was good. One of the strengths that came to me in being there in northern Ohio along a river, two friends came to visit me. Both of them have their share of challenges. One is my longest friendship in all of life. He's my best buddy from grade school. He came down one night just for dinner, didn't stay. His wife is getting ready for a bone marrow transplant at Cleveland Clinic. They've had real struggle and ache in their world, and he is claiming the stripes of Jesus by which we are healed. And they're going into this with the faith throttle moved forward. My friend, whose name is Boom, also talked about tithing as a way of expressing his gratitude to God for God's faithfulness and care. And in the midst of their own struggle, they're continuing to sing God's praises, knowing that this Lord won't let go of them. And they're hearing brave music in the middle of all of this. 2 days later, my best backpacking buddy came down just for lunch. And my friend Steve, whom I've backpacked with for 25 years, can't backpack anymore. In fact, he can't even camp. He can't sleep on the ground. He has an autoimmune disease, perhaps precipitated by life in the factories. And it means that his rib cage is fused and he can't get enough air. And he talks about how good God has been to him in the midst of these challenges and the encouragement he feels and the points of life he is still able to fully live and embrace because this God is so faithful to him. He too talked to me about tithing, about how he continually looks for ways to demonstrate his confidence and faithfulness in God's care. And I have to tell you, being in the company of these brothers lifts me. It's an encourager to me. It helps me hear this music again, that God is in control of the world and our lives if we will only be willing to relinquish enough to allow his arms to enfold us. This Lord would die to make that real, and he lives so that we might know that in this life and in the life to come, nothing can escape his touch, his caress, his desire to love us and enfold us. Some of you, if you were fortunate, made your way in the last couple of weeks down to the Ensemble Theater, and you saw His Eye is on the Sparrow, the story of Ethel Waters. What a brilliant production. What a faith-filled lady who had such painful experiences in her life to grow through. And bless Billy Graham for his persistence in staying connected to her in such a way that later in her life she would be able to give her full witness to millions. I can still see her, that beaming confidence in God, no matter what. Oh, she could hear the music. And she sang in a way that brought it closer to our souls. Some of you may find that this scripture reading for today seems a little unusual for today. It hardly is. Jesus is in the synagogue. He's handed the scroll to read, which would be a custom. And then he begins with these words from the prophet Isaiah, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me," listen carefully, "because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." Up until then, they were cheering for him. That's Joe's boy. He says, "Today in your hearing, these words have been fulfilled." What? He goes on and makes reference to several individuals who would be regarded as a pagan who had received a special measure of God's strength and grace at a time of need. And the good Jewish folk in that synagogue were enraged because they felt they had a corner on God's grace. Oh, no. That's not the kind of grace Jesus came to bring. He came to bring good news for all people. To preach good news. To help those of us who are blind and deaf to see, to hear, to know. To trust in the movement of God in our midst. To release those of us who are captive. We're captive to fear. We're captive to darkness. We're often blinded to what God can do, and Jesus ignites that whole reality and that whole conversation. This is his first sermon, and they tried to murder him. And he would pay the price of preaching again and again and again, hoping that those of us who were dull of hearing would essentially get it and allow the Lord such beautiful maneuvering room to do what God alone can do, and that is to heal our broken hearts, to transform our battered lives, and to help us step in and to sing that brave music that echoes the wonders of his care. I'm firmly convinced that if you want to hear the music better, the music of God's aliveness for you and me, then you want to open your heart to know Jesus more deeply. And remember where all this began? Because he comes to you and to me saying, with the gift of his life to us, "I want to hold your hand." That's pretty special. No, that's everything. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Dear friends, we have the privilege at this time to recognize a very special group who minister on your behalf as a part of our prayer ministry. I'd like to invite any of our prayer team members who are here in this service to please come forward. Would you please? And when we talk about people willing to stand alongside us together during a time of challenge or darkness, these are some of the faces of the folk who do this. David Poland, Gene Otterson, please. Susan Schultz, Todd Techmeyer, Joyce Drake, Dana Wilbur. There are others who couldn't be here today. Sally Gates and Errol Everson. Last week we made the point of saying perhaps the best way we can love somebody is to pray for them. These persons are the loving hand of Christ in our midst to help and encourage us all. And we just want to say thanks be to God for what he's led you to do. Dear friends, as we gather here now, we are also exceedingly grateful for the flowers given by Linda Hill in honor of her parents and children, and her loving gratitude. This has been a week where the gospel was lifted up at the royal wedding. Help us to sense that power of love that we have the gift of giving away. We remember the families from Santa Fe, Texas, who know the devastation of another school shooting, innocent lives lost, and we ask for help to find a way to protect our children and all people. We think of Cuban families reeling from a tragic plane crash. The brokenness in our own lives and the things we can't quite put words on, but the Lord knows and understands and walks with us through. And so ever grateful for Christ's unfailing care, please join with me in a moment of prayer. Lord, we thank you for obstacles that have been overcome, unexpected light in our time of despair, heartbreaks which have been redeemed. We ask your mercy for the hurts which have not been dropped, from the promises that we have not kept, asking that you would take from us the burdens we've yet to release, the anxiety and fear our best resolve has not overcome. Give us, Lord, a sensitivity of spirit on this day when we celebrate the gift of your spirit to your people. Give us a sensitivity of spirit that we may listen with attention and understand with compassion. We thank you for our prayer team members and their patience, their openness and availability to come alongside and pray. Give to us a sense of humor that we may never take ourselves too seriously. Keep from us the eyes which see nothing but faults, the minds which only think the worst, the tongue which delights in criticizing. Help us to think with kindness, to speak with courtesy, to act in love. Help us to live as those who have been with Jesus, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And you know, for all I know, we're likely having members of our church family who are on the runway getting ready to leave for Israel, streaming this service. We have a group of 26 leaving this morning, and we pray that their experience will be rich and life-changing, and I encourage you to keep them in your prayers over the next 10 days. And now, may we respond to God's goodness by sharing in our tithes and offerings. Once more with meaning. Bless you. Thank you. When Jesus and the 11 disciples were to leave the upper room and go to the Garden of Gethsemane, they left having sung a hymn. May the music of God's grace for your life fill you and thrill you and make you whole so that you can go with joy, live in faith, believe that life is good, and if you find it not, help make it so. To the glory of God who made us, and may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship, friendship, and power of the Holy Spirit lead us forward together each step of the way. Amen. Thank you.